As we mark 300,000 deaths from COVID, a deal to provide economic relief still eludes lawmakers. Time is running out as benefits from the CARES Act expire the day after Christmas. A bipartisan group has now offered two proposals this afternoon to try to break the gridlock. West Virginia Senator Joe Manchin is one of the key architects, and he joins us now from Capitol Hill. Senator Manchin, thank you very much for joining us again. Tell us why your why your proposal is now broken up into two separate bills.
Well, it's not just mine. This has been a group of people that have started together in a bipartisan way. It started after the election on November the 4th. We made phone calls back and forth, those of us who have always worked together, and said, we got to do something. Talk to Susan, talk to Lisa, talk to all my friends, Mitt, all my Democratic friends. We had a dinner at Lisa's house. There was eight of us there, the gang of eight, I guess, and it grew exponentially. We now have a unanimous group of people that have agreed on $748 billion that takes care of all of the emergency needs that we have that will expire at the end of December, Judy. So people will not go without unemployment checks. It's $300 a week for 16 weeks. They will not go without food assistance. We put over $13 billion and even helping basically food banks and everyone else who is feeding people that they never fed before because of hard times. We're taking care of health care. We're taking care of basically the needs that people have as a lifeline. All the emergencies are taken care of in this bill, unanimous Democrat and Republican. There's no reason why this wouldn't be passed immediately if they put it on the floor. And the only thing I can tell everybody, help is on the way. We're not leaving. We will not go home for Christmas. We will not leave this place until that bill is passed.
And do you have reason to believe that you're going to get the support of the leadership and the majority of both political parties behind what you're putting forward?
Well, there's no reason why not. We've been working and growing this group of Democrats and Republicans, from Dick Durbin to Rob Portman, people well respected within their political caucuses, if you will, Democrat and Republican. We've gotten people all in between. And this is the only game in town. There's nobody else has done what we've done and stuck with it. Nobody thought we would have a bill. We have a bill of $748 billion, close to 600 pages we put together and presented it tonight. It'll be on the internet. You can see it. You can look at every piece of it. It's not perfect. I'm sure of that. People are going to say, well, there's things you left out. I remind you, this is an emergency COVID relief bill. Only until April 1, Joe Biden comes in as our president in January. He can evaluate the economy, what we need to be doing, and present more if needed. This gets us through
Senator,
the most difficult, challenging times.
Excuse me, Senator, I listened to your news conference with the other Republicans and Democrats who are on board with you on this compromise, which raises the question, where is the leadership and the rest of these two political parties? As we know, for the Democrats, one of the main sticking points has been aid for state and local governments. That money appears to be in the second proposal, as well as so-called liability protections for businesses, hospitals, and others. My question on that is, why isn't there agreement there? And is that still going to hold up agreement on this, what you put forward?
That should not hold agreement up on this. We would love to have one bill. We've agreed on $908 billion, $160 billion for state and local need. There's an awful lot of states. And there's a lot of people, basically first responders, whether it be policemen, firemen, whatever, that we, essential services that we need in every state, that are basically reducing their workforce because of a lack of revenue. That needs to be attended to. The other is liability. My Republican friends believe very strongly that businesses shouldn't be able to be sued out of business. We as Democrats believe that too. Where they break down in differences is how your ability to be able to get into court, Judy. How do you protect the workplace? How do you protect the worker? We've narrowed it down to just a period of time. It's only for 2 years, 1 year prior, starting in December 2019, and it ends in the end of 2021. So it's a very short period of time.
I'm sorry to interrupt again, but it's my understanding that you are at this point are the only Democrats supporting what the Republicans want in terms of liability protection. But what we're hearing, though, from Democrats, Senator, is that they're really worried about people who work in these high vulnerability jobs, like at meatpacking plants, where it would be at a huge disadvantage, where they would stand to lose their jobs, or rather lose protection and coverage by their employer. If they got sick.
Judy, they have workers' comp. All the people who are working for the large companies or working for any company has workers' compensation to take care of. I mean, yeah, workers' comp, in case they get hurt. We know that. We're worried about people basically that might go into the store and says, I contracted in your place of business because your employers weren't safe enough, you didn't sanitize enough, things of that sort. There's a lot of things we didn't know. I went ahead and signed on to that bill with my Republican colleagues in the spirit of bipartisanship, because basically everyone has to give and take. My reason is they shorten their time element from 5 years to 2 years. 1 year back, 1 year forward. Not 1 year back and 4 years forward, and made some other critical changes. I'm sure it's not good enough for a lot of people, but here's the thing, Judy. If for some reason they can't come to an agreement, and the Senate and the House, Democrats and Republicans, won't agree, then that stays by itself, because those two are one bill, liability and state and local help. The 748 is the emergency bill, Judy. That takes care of every need every American has with their lifeline for housing, rental, basically everything that's needed for you to survive, get through the worst quarter of next year, which is going to be the first quarter.
So as we stand here tonight, Senator Manchin, how confident are you that that aid bill, the $748 billion, will pass whether or not there's agreement on the other issues around liability protection and aid for state and local governments?
Judy, I'm as confident as I am standing here talking to you that this is real. This language is done. The bill was, this is not just a concept. 2 weeks ago, we gave basically an outline. That's all we have, was an outline showing you how we come to 908. We worked it and worked it and worked it for the last 30 days, morning, noon, and night. Our staff's been going around. We've been on Zoom calls and phone calls continuously every day. We've come to this after a lot of discussions, back and forth bantering, talking to our caucuses, respectively, Democrat and Republican, and representing them. No one else has done anything like this. If the leadership all of a sudden wants to reinvent the wheel, that's what they would be doing. We would hope that they would say, thank you all for what you've done, because sometimes they hit an impasse.
Well,
we were able to work past that impasse, and we have a bill. I'm confident. And if they want to stay here for Christmas, I'll be right with them.
Well, we saw the bipartisanship today. We'll see what the leadership does. Senator Joe Manchin of West Virginia, we thank you.
Thank you, Judy.